The Battle of the Yser was a battle of the First World War that took place in October 1914 between the towns of Nieuwpoort and Diksmuide, along a 35 km stretch of the Yser River and the Yperlee Canal, in Belgium. The front line was held by a large Belgian force, which halted the German advance in a costly defensive battle. The victory at the Yser allowed Belgium to retain a sliver of territory with Germany in control of 95% of Belgian territory, which made King Albert a Belgian national hero, sustained national pride and provided a venue for commemorations of heroic sacrifice for the next century. Chapter 1, Background. Chapter 1, Section 1, German Invasion of Belgium. On the 2nd of August 1914, the Belgian government refused passage through Belgium to German troops, and on the night of 3/4 August the Belgian General Staff ordered the 3rd Division to Liège to obstruct a German advance. The German army invaded Belgium on the morning of the 4th of August. Covered by the 3rd Division, the Liège fortress garrison, a screen of the cavalry division and detachments from Liège and Namur, the Belgian field army closed up to the River Gita, and by the 4th of August, the 1st Division had assembled at Tienen, the 5th Division at Purwes, the 2nd Division at Leuven and the 6th Division at Wavre, covering central and western Belgium and communications towards Antwerp. German cavalry appeared at Weiss early on the 4th of August, to find the bridge down and Belgian troops on the west bank. The Germans crossed at a ford and forced the Belgians to retire towards Liège. By evening, it was clear to the Belgian High Command that the 3rd Division and the Liège garrison were in the path of a very large invasion force. With information that 5 German corps and 6 reserve corps were in Belgium and with no immediate support available from the French army and British expeditionary force, the Belgian field army was ordered to withdraw towards the national redoubt on the evening of the 18th of August and arrived on the 20th of August. At an engagement between the 1st Division and the German 9 Corps near Tienen, the Belgians suffered 1,630 casualties. The Belgian government of Charles de Broqueville left Brussels for Antwerp, and the Belgian capital was occupied unopposed on the 20th of August, as the Belgian field army completed its retreat to Antwerp. The German siege of Namur ended with a Belgian capitulation on the 24th of August, as the field army made a sortie from Antwerp towards Brussels. The Germans detached the 3rd Reserve Corps from the 1st Army to mask the city and a division of the 4th Reserve Corps to occupy Brussels. On the 1st of October, General Hans Hartwig von Bissella ordered an attack on the Antwerp forts, St. Catalina Waver, Walem and the Bosbeek, and Dorpfeld redoubts by the 5th Reserve and Marine Divisions. By 11 a.m. Fort Walem was severely damaged. Fort Lyre had been hit by a 16-inch shell, Fort Koningsuecht and the Talbot and Bosbeek redoubts were mostly intact, and the intervening ground between Fort St. Catalina Waver and Dorpfeld redoubt had been captured. A counterattack failed and the 4th Division was reduced to 4,800 infantry. The Belgian commanders ordered the left flank of the army to withdraw to a line north of the Nieti, which covered the gap in the outer defences and kept the city out of range of German super-heavy artillery. Proclamations warning the inhabitants that King Albert I and the government would leave Antwerp were put up during the day. Early on the 9th of October, German troops found some forts of the inner ring empty. Bissella ended the bombardment and summoned the military governor, General Victor Degeis, to surrender. About 30,000 men of the Antwerp garrison surrendered, and the city was occupied by German troops. About 33,000 soldiers of the garrison fled north to the Netherlands, where they were interned for the duration. During the siege of Antwerp, the German and French armies fought the Battle of the Frontiers, and then the German armies in the north pursued the French and the Bif southwards into France in the Great Retreat, which culminated in the First Battle of the Marne, followed by the First Battle of the Aisne. Reciprocal attempts by the Franco-British and German armies to envelop the northern flank of the opposing army, the race to the sea took place through Picardy, Artois and Flanders, the 17th September to the 19th October. The race ended on the North Sea coast of Belgium, when the last open area from Diksmuide to the North Sea was occupied by Belgian troops from Antwerp. Chapter 1, Section 2, Allied Retreat to the Yser. British and French forces in Belgium covered the withdrawal of the Belgians and British from Antwerp. The 1st, 3rd and 4th Divisions reached Ostend, the 5th and 6th Divisions arrived at Torhout and Diksmuide, and the Antwerp garrison troops moved to an area northwest of Ghent. The Germans' 4th Ersatz Division and Landwehr troops at Lorcheren and Mabeek turned east towards Ghent before the withdrawal was discovered. The 3rd Reserve Corps and the 4th Ersatz Division were then ordered to turn west and advance on Kortrijk to prolong the main German front, before being sent towards Ghent and Bruges, with orders to reach Blankenberge and Ostend on the coast. On the 11th of October, German troops were detected advancing on Ghent, by which time the Belgian fortress troops had joined the field army. A retreat from Ghent from 3 o'clock to 10 p.m. began, after which German troops entered the city. Several bridges were demolished during the retirement, although crowds of civilians on the main road and rail bridges led to them being left intact. By the 18th of October, the Belgian, British and French troops in northern France and Belgium had formed a defensive line. The British II Corps assembled with the 5th Division from La Bassée Canal north to Beaupuy, the 3rd Division from Illies to Aubers, and 3 divisions of the French Cavalry Corps deployed from Fromelles to Le Mesnil. The British III Corps had the 6th Division from Radinghem to Epinette and the 4th Division from Epinette to Pont Rouge, the BIF Cavalry Corps with the 1st and 2nd Cavalry Divisions, from Douaumont to Tonbriellen. The British IV Corps with the 7th Division and 3rd Cavalry Division from Zandvoort to Oost-Ukerke, the French Group Bidon, and the Demeitery Cavalry Corps covered the ground from Rousselaere to Kortermark, the 87th and 89th Territorial Divisions from Passendale to Borzing, and then the Belgian Field Army and Fortress Troops, from Borzing to Nieuwpoort. The Brigade de Fusiliers Marin. The Fusiliers Marin comprised 6 battalions of mostly reservists, with 6,670 men, of whom 1,450 were fusiliers, a machine gun company and 4 machine guns in each battalion. Chapter 1, Section 3, Flanders Terrain. Part of northern France and north Belgium from the Pas de Calais to the Scheldt estuary had been known as Flanders since the 11th century. West of a line between Arras and Calais in the north of France lie chalk downlands covered with soil sufficient for arable farming, and east of the line the land declines in a series of spurs into the Flanders Plain. By 1914, the plain was bounded by canals linking Douai, Bethune, Saint-Omer and Calais. To the southeast, canals run between Lens, Lille, Roubaix, and Kortrijk, the Lys River from Kortrijk to Ghent, and to the northwest lies the sea. The plain is almost flat, apart from a line of low hills from Kassel, east to Mont des Cats, Zwarteberg, Rodeberg, Scherpenberg and Kemmelberg. From Kemmel, a low ridge lies to the northeast, declining in elevation past Ypres through Wijdschaat, Jeluweld and Passendale, curving north then northwest to Diksmuide where it merges with the plain. A coastal strip about 10 miles wide is near sea level and fringed by sand dunes. Inland the ground is mainly meadow, cut by canals, dikes, drainage ditches and roads built up on causeways. The Lys, Yser and the Upper Scheldt have been canalized, and between them the water level underground is close to the surface, rises further in the autumn and fills any dip, the sides of which then collapse. The ground surface quickly turns to a consistency of cream cheese, and on the coast, troop movements were confined to roads, except during frosts. The rest of the Flanders Plain is woods and small fields, divided by hedgerows planted with trees and cultivated from small villages and farms. The terrain was difficult for infantry operations because of the lack of observation, impossible for mounted action because of the many obstructions, and difficult for artillery because of the limited view. South of La Bassée Canal around Lens and Bethune was a coal mining district full of slag heaps, pit heads and miners' houses. North of the canal, the cities of Lille, Tourcoing and Roubaix form a manufacturing complex, with outlying industries at Armentières, Comines, Pelouin, and Menon, along the Lys River, with isolated sugar beet and alcohol refineries and a steel works near Air-sur-la-Lys. Intervening areas are agricultural, with wide roads on shallow foundations, unpaved mud tracks in France and narrow paved roads along the frontier and in Belgium. In France, the roads were closed by the local authorities during thaws to preserve the surface and marked by barriers fermés, which in 1914 were ignored by British lorry drivers. The difficulty of movement after the end of summer absorbed much of the civilian labor available on road maintenance, leaving field defenses to be built by frontline soldiers. Chapter 2, Prelude. The Belgian retreat continued on 11 and the 12th of October, covered by cavalry, cyclists and motor machine gun sections. On the 14th of October, the Belgian army began to dig in along the Yser, the 6th and 5th divisions to the north of French territorial divisions, assembled at Borzing, then northwards along the Yser Canal to the Fusiliers Marin at Diksmuide. The 4th, 1st and 2nd divisions prolonged the line north, with advanced posts at Beest, Kiem, Schur and Manikensveer, about 1 mile forward on the east bank. A bridgehead was also held near the coast around Lombardside and West End, to cover Nieuwpoort, with the 2nd Cavalry Division in reserve. On the 18th of October, the French 87th and 89th Territorial Divisions took over the defence of the front line south of Fort Conocoa from the 6th Division, which was moved to the Yser front. On the 21st of October, the hard-pressed Belgian army was reinforced by the French 42nd Division. The Allies assembled a naval force under the British Admiral Horace Hood with three monitors, HMS 7, Humber, Mersey and assorted craft to provide heavy artillery support to the defenders of the seaward flank. The German forces comprised the new 4th Army, with the 3rd Reserve Corps from Antwerp and 4 new Reserve Corps from Germany, along with cavalry and heavy artillery units. It moved southwards from Bruges and Ostend in the direction of the Yser River, to take the line from Nieuwpoort to Ypres. Chapter 3, Battle. On the 16th of October, Diksmuide, garrisoned by Belgian and French troops under Colonel Alphonse Jacques, was attacked. Despite many casualties, the Belgians and French held the town. The press, politicians, literary figures and the military channeled public opinion, making out that the defense of the town was both strategic and heroic. On the 18th of October, the German offensive began and overran Allied troops from Nieuwpoort southwards to Arras. The objective was to defeat the Belgian and French armies and to deprive the British of access to Calais, Boulogne, and Dunkirk. The 3rd Reserve Corps attacked Belgian defences from Diksmuide to the sea, regardless of loss. The Germans captured advanced posts at Kiem, Schur and part of Manikensveer and reached the Yser, despite bombardments from the Anglo-French flotilla, which engaged German troops along the coast as far as Middelkerke. The 4th Ersatz Division was forbidden to cross the Yser at Nieuwpoort because of the shell fire from the Allied ships. On the 21st of October, the Germans established a small bridgehead on the west bank, despite a counterattack by the French 42nd Division, which had just arrived, and the last bridge was blown on the 23rd of October. Diksmuide was constantly bombarded and attacked, but the defenders managed to hold on. The Grand Quartier General, the French High Command, plans to flood the land to obstruct the Germans, which would trap the Belgian army between the flood and the Germans or force them to abandon the last part of unoccupied Belgium. The plan was postponed because the Belgian army was preparing to flood the area between the Yser and its tributary canals. On the 25th of October, the German pressure on the Belgians was so great that a decision was taken to inundate the Belgian front line. After an abortive attempt on the 21st of October, the Belgians managed to open the sluices at Nieuwpoort during the nights of 26 to 30 October, during high tides, steadily raising the water level until an impassable flooded area was created of about 1 mi wide, stretching as far south as Diksmuide. The Germans attacked again on the Yser front on the 30th of October, overran the Belgian second line and reached Ramscapelle and Pavijs. Belgian and French counterattacks recovered Ramscapelle, and the final attack, planned for the next day, was called off when the Germans realized that the land behind them was flooding. The Germans withdrew in the night of 30-31 October. On the 10th of November, Diksmuide fell, and the fighting continued further south until 22 November, in the First Battle of Ypres. Chapter 4, Aftermath. The Belgian army and its allies had managed to hold the last corner of Belgium, ending the race to the sea and the period of open warfare. The front line along the Yser River became known as the Yser Front and was held by the Belgian army until 1918. James Edward Edmonds wrote in 1925, in the History of the Great War, that from 18 October to the 30th of November 1914, between Gaylevelt and the coast, the Germans suffered an estimated 76,250 casualties. In 2010, Jack Sheldon wrote that from 18 to 30 October, the Belgian army sustained 20,000 casualties and that German casualties may have been much greater. The struggle of the Belgian army to hold on to its territory during the remainder of the war and the experiences of ordinary Flemish infantrymen led to an increase in Flemish national sentiment and the foundation of the Front Beweging, the first party of the Flemish movement, in 1917. Chapter 5, Sources. Chapter 5, Section 1, Books.